Hosanna. Well, hello. I'm Kevin Shaw, and today we're bringing you the news of how the King comes to Jerusalem this Palm Sunday. We're doing that through the Gospel according to St. Mark in chapter 11, verses 1 to 25, which I'll now read from the ESV. And this concerns the triumphal entry. So Mark 11, starting at the first verse. Now, when they drew near to Jerusalem, to Bethphage and Bethany, at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples, and he said to them, "Go into the village in front of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find a colt tied, on which no one has ever sat. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, 'What are you doing?' say, 'The Lord has need of it, and will send it back here immediately.' And they went away, and they found a colt tied at a door outside in the street, and they untied it. And some of those standing there said to them, 'What are you doing, untying the colt?' And they told them what Jesus had said, and they let them go. And they brought the colt to Jesus, and they threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. And many spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut from the fields. And those who went before and those who followed were shouting, 'Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest.' And he entered Jerusalem and went into the temple. And when he had looked around at everything, as it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. On the following day, when they came from Bethany, he was hungry. And seeing in the distance a fig tree in leaf, he went to see if he could find anything on it. And when he came to it, he found nothing but leaves, for it was not the season for figs. And he said to it, 'May no one ever eat fruit from you again.' And his disciples heard it. And they came to Jerusalem. And he entered the temple and began to drive out those who sold and those who bought in the temple. And he overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats of those who sold pigeons. And he would not allow anyone to carry anything through the temple. And he was teaching them and saying to them, 'Is it not written, My house shall be called a house of prayer for all the nations? But you have made it a den of robbers.' And the chief priests and the scribes heard it and were seeking a way to destroy him, for they feared him, because all the crowd was astonished at his teaching. And when evening came, they went out of the city. And as they passed by in the morning, they saw the fig tree withered away to its roots. And Peter remembered and said to him, 'Rabbi, look, the fig tree that you have cursed has withered.' And Jesus answered them, 'Have faith in God. Truly, I say to you, whoever says to this mountain, "Be taken up and thrown into the sea," and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that what he says will come to pass, it will be done for him. And therefore I tell you, whatever you ask in prayer, believe that you have received it, and it will be yours. And whenever you stand praying, forgive, if you have anything against anyone, so that your Father, who also is in heaven, may forgive you your trespasses." This is the word of the Lord, and thanks be to God. So, Lord, please guide me to speak your truth and for our hearts to recognize our King and to worship him fully through our understanding of this passage. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, news this week continues to be dominated by Ukraine. And I'm sure, like many others, I am particularly appalled to see how the Russian military units operating north of Kiev have chosen to act, flagrantly engaged in almost every type of war crime. We see commanders betraying the military integrity that they profess to uphold. And we see individuals demonstrating a moral framework no better than those of the rebel movements of Central Africa or the terrorist organisations of the Middle East. My heart goes out to the people of the Rudina, the Russian motherland, who I know will despair when they eventually do learn what is being done in their name. And our passage today concerns Jesus' despair over the bankrupt moral framework of the chief priests and the scribes, who had allowed the temple to become a den of robbers, who had lost their religious integrity, with which their house of prayer was supposed to provide to all the nations. And so we're going to look at this passage in three parts. First, we have the king who is arriving, as announced in prophecy. Then we have the king pronouncing judgment from that prophecy. And then we come on to the king inviting people into a relationship with him. But today, we're focused, this Palm Sunday, on the king who's coming to Jerusalem. All the Gospels tell of this triumphal entry, but today we're doing it through the eyes of Mark, whose twist is probably more stark than the other Gospel writers. Last week, we had the story of the blind man seeing from Mark chapter 8. Mark goes on to with some discourses from Jesus, and then he presents us with Jesus finishing in Jericho, where he heals blind Bartimaeus. And our passage today starts as Jesus and his disciples approach Jerusalem, having travelled from Jericho. That means they've walked a steep road, which climbs some 3,500 feet in 15 miles. And it takes them 6 hours to walk it when unencumbered. And they reach the village of Bethany, the home of Mary, Martha, and Lazarus, where Jesus tended to stay when he was visiting Jerusalem or the surrounding area. But Mark also mentions Bethphage, which means the house of unripe figs. Some think it was another village. Some think it was a homestead farm, where in the warmth of the valley, it produced the first fruit figs, which would have been presented in the temple. And there are two roads that lead out of Bethany. There's the main Jericho to Jerusalem road, which heads east-west, and that passes to the south of the Mount of Olives. But there was another road, which headed north across the valley before turning west to skirt the Mount of Olives to the north. And it seems that two disciples were directed to the small village across the valley to the north of Bethany to collect the foal, while Jesus and the remaining 10 disciples travelled west on the main road to meet up again where the roads joined just to the west of the Mount of Olives and under the walls of Jerusalem. Mark tells how Jesus carefully told the disciples exactly what to say on taking the foal. And none of the Gospel writers dwell on this as if it was a particularly miraculous event, and so it does seem that this provision of the foal is pre-arranged, but of course with God's hand on its safe execution. So the stage has been set. It's mid-afternoon after this long journey. We have the foal, the colt of the donkey, and Jerusalem is thronging with people who've arrived early for the Passover. And so Jesus, who's very much likely dressed as a rabbi, gets on this foal and rides past the walls of the city with the crowds of Jewish pilgrims hailing him as king, grabbing the cut palm fronds from the side of the road to lay before him. And under the watchful eyes of all who could look out from the city. So why is Jesus engaged in this theatre? This isn't the thing that he normally tried to do. He normally tried to avoid the attention. And why do the crowds respond in this way? How is it that they proclaim him as king today and yet chant for his death in a few days' time? Well, Jesus does it being very aware of the prophecy of Zechariah chapter 9, verse 9, concerning the coming of the king of Zion. Where Zechariah says, "Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. Righteous and having salvation is he. Humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." Now, this passage is in the form of poetry. And importantly, The pilgrims, well-educated Jews, will have known it. Zechariah was expressing for them what had become the yearning to be free of Roman oppression. This was very much the freedom literature of the day. And so, of course, they knew it. And they may have actually been chanting this poetry on their journey, like other psalms of ascent. And so the people didn't actually need to recognize Jesus as Messiah in order to participate. For many, this was live theater that they could join in because they knew their lines already. And this makes me feel uncomfortable. If we look for the application to our lives today, is it possible that we know our lines? We know what to say, we know what to do, but is it possible that we've missed the point and we fail to see the Messiah right in front of us? And what if we understand and we do recognize that this must be the Messiah? The well-educated Jews, the chief priests and the scribes will have understood that Jesus was arriving in fulfillment of this prophecy. He was challenging them in arriving at the gate of Jerusalem as the King of Zion, as the Messiah. And they also understood the implied criticism of the next part of prophecy, which we're about to come on to. So what did those educated Jews do? What could they do, those who could see what was in front of them? And are we at risk of overlooking the evidence in front of us? But let's return to the story. So here Jesus enters Jerusalem. Now, whilst there was a gate at the temple, it was much more likely that he came in by the lower gate. This makes sure that he traverses the city of David, part of what the claim that he was making, on his route up Mount Moriah to the temple. By doing that, he was also fulfilling one of the 44 or so messianic prophecies. And in the temple, it would have been normal to present some form of offering. It might have been some of those unripe figs from Bethphage, which Mark did draw our attention to. But Mark mentions here only that he went on to survey all that was going on in the temple. And he saw the robbery of the pilgrims, the cacophony of the merchants, in what had become a bazaar in the court of the Gentiles, instead of being a house of prayer for all the nations. And Jesus likely knew what he was going to do, but it was late, and the city gates would be closing at sundown, and he was tired from the journey, and so they returned to Bethany, ready for the following day. So, we now know the setting. Now, I pause to reflect that in the news this week, we learned that Richard Osman is due to leave the quiz show Pointless, where he's filmed more than 1,300 episodes since 2009. Richard Osman created the show and stars with what seems to be an incredible ability to provide a depth of additional knowledge and trivia about the pointless topics. And I can't help thinking that the chief priests and the scribes were deeply imbued in what had become pointless forms of worship, giving status and meaning to the wrong types of trivia. They needed a new Richard Osman who could look beyond their pointless ways with a proper context and a depth of knowledge of the scriptures. And of course, one had just walked past them on a donkey, if only they could see him for who he was. And so we start day two with the strange story of the fig tree. In Luke's account, the fig tree withers immediately, but Mark uses a literary device which he employs several times through his gospel. And he splits the story of the fig tree and uses it as a sandwich to illustrate and provide comment on the story which it encompasses. Now, in the climate of Israel, fig trees usually produce fruit twice a year. The first crop grows slowly from the previous year's buds and then ripens at around June. This is followed by fast new growth and a second crop around September. So at the time of Passover, any figs, if they did exist, would have been green, unripe, and perhaps more resembling leaf buds. So why did Jesus curse this fig tree? It was not the season for it to fruit. Was he really expecting fruit? Well, no. And this is not a vindictive Jesus who's expressing his frustration on the tree with a curse on it. This is actually Jesus physically enacting a parable, and this is how Mark reports it. For the fig tree represents the heart of the Israelite nation, which was bound up in worship of God. And the worship was focused in and through the temple. But the soul of Israel had dried up. and the worship of the people was crushed by the noise and bustle of the merchants. It was crushed by those who were using the temple gate as a shortcut into the city. And it was crushed by the extortion of the worshippers, and in particular the foreigners who were easy targets. And this is what Zechariah went on to refer to in his prophecy from chapter 9, picking up at verse 11. As for you also, because of the blood of my covenant with you, I will set your prisoners free from this waterless pit. Return to your stronghold, O prisoners of hope. Today I declare that I will restore to you double. And so temple worship had become like a dry water system. Jesus was freeing people from this barren, empty activity in the temple, which was no worship at all. And he did so physically on this day, as he taught the people what the temple worship was supposed to be about. But he also freed us from the geography of this temple worship through the blood of his new covenant, meaning that we do have the freedom to worship anywhere and everywhere, anytime and even all the time. So I could speak more on this, but we need to return to our passage. Where Zechariah's prophecy also identified how this king would upend the old order. In verse 10 he says, I will cut off the chariot from Ephraim and the war horse from Jerusalem. And the battle bow shall be cut off, and he shall speak peace to the nations. And his rule will be from sea to sea and from the river to the ends of the earth. The chief priests and the scribes knew this passage, and they would have been severely uncomfortable when they saw the preceding verses of this passage played out before their eyes. They knew it was a harbinger of the ones to come. And to make the point really clear to his disciples and the significant numbers of people who now followed him, the fig tree was the example that Jesus used to illustrate this and how it was similarly withered. It wasn't as if the tree could regrow. It had withered to its roots. And so had the legalistic, oppressive, exploitative worship of the Jewish nation at the hands of the religious authorities in Jerusalem. So God was cutting it off with a new king, speaking peace to the nations and ruling to the ends of the earth. Now Mark doesn't bother explaining the physical parable of the withered tree any further. For him, the point is very clearly made. And so he focuses on the third part of what I wanted to cover today, on Jesus telling us how things work in this new relationship with God and under the hand of Jesus the King. And it's not about temple worship or ritual. No, it's about faith in God, having a close enough relationship to be able to pray in faith and expectation of that prayer being answered. Now, it's not about any prayer being answered. It's also, because Mark makes it, it's also about that faith, having that faith in God. And it's that faith which moves us closer to God and enables our prayers to be aligned to the Father's intent and purposes. And when he talks about having no doubt in your heart, he's referring also to the need for a heart that's malleable to God's leading. And Paul recognized this in his letter to the Ephesians when he warned them of those who, in their futility, are darkened in their understanding, alienated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to the hardness of their hearts. And so we have here an illustration how the hardness of heart sustains ignorance. But for Mark, a malleable heart, aligned to God, gains understanding and faith. And it also means treating others as Jesus chose, forgiving even those who executed him. It will seldom be about a mountain being thrown into the sea, but as the children in an orphanage in a neglected part of Hong Kong discovered, it might be. For their orphanage was not well off, the view was obscured, and they needed to extend the building, but it was hemmed in by the steep cliffs in front of it. They couldn't afford to move, and so they prayed about it. And it so happened that the runway at Kai Tak, which was the previous runway for Hong Kong, and it needed extending into the sea. And so the mountain obstructing any development of the orphanage was excavated, and it was thrown into the sea to extend the runway. But it then provided the answer to the prayer for the children of the orphanage. But to return, Mark also tells us how the morally bankrupt will wither and be cut off. Those who are aligned to this king, however, cannot lose. And John explains to Christians who weren't quite sure in his epistle, and he says in 1 John 5:20, and we know that the Son of God has come and given us understanding, so that we may know him who is true, and we are in him who is true, in his Son Jesus Christ, for he is the true God and eternal life. And so how can we reflect on this? Well, I started by talking about Ukraine, and in real life we see the mighty war machine of Russia that has actually in some places ground to a halt and been forced to retreat by this man in a t-shirt. And the morally bankrupt and those with hardened hearts will be cut off, which is effectively what we see through the response of the West to Russia. And so the man in the t-shirt may lose the battles, but actually we can be fairly assured that he will ultimately win the war. And if we now have a look at the Bible view of life and the parallels, we see the spiritually and morally bankrupt will be cut off. That's the message that Mark was giving us. We need hearts aligned to God through faith. And in doing that, we align ourselves to the true God. For as John reassures us, the true God will win. And so for us, it's the man or woman in the Christian t-shirt who will win. And as we enter this Holy Week, and we look forward again to the coming of this King, let us reflect on which group we associate ourselves with from the triumphant entry. How might we worship God more fully? How might we flourish in and through our worship, growing closer to him? And so how might we engage the world through an effective prayer life aligned to his will? So what can you do this week to align yourself to this King? Let us pray. So Lord, we long to worship you with hearts aligned to you. Help us to understand so that we can avoid being like the bystanders of that first Palm Sunday and gain the insight of the disciples to be effective in prayer and faithful in taking your kingdom to others. In the name of this King, we pray. Amen. So now, let us worship our great King. Let's sing.
Steve.